You're watching the Wilkshire Man channel, only on YouTube.
Hi everybody, thanks for joining me for part three of the catapult series. I'm back out into my piece of local woodland that I got permission to camp. I come to this spot quite frequently. This is a solo overnighter. Most of my camps are solo, although just recently I've been very fortunate to be invited to various other people's camps, for which I'm very grateful. It's always nice to camp in company, but it's also nice to camp solo, and you could just, I think, tune in more to the vibes of the surroundings when you're solo and on your own. Having said that, I got my little dog Alsa with me. But anyway, I am here to test my catapult out. I've cast some lead ammo, 12mm lead, so I'll show you that. Without any further ado, because it is looking a little inclement, we've had a cold front go past in the last 12 hours, and they're forecasting unsettled weather for the next sort of two or three days, so there's a good chance we're going to get rain as well during this camp, so I'm looking forward to that. Really like the rain. Also, I'm approaching 10,000 subscribers, so I'm very grateful for all of you tuning into my channel, and hope that you're benefiting from watching what I do. This is something that I've done on and off since I was a child. I was brought up in the countryside. I lived all my life until I got married in a couple of local villages, and I'm very much a countryman, I suppose, at heart, really. So it's kind of natural for me to be out here doing this sort of thing. Anyway, as I say, without any further ado, I'm going to get the tarp up now before it rains, and then perhaps do some catapult shooting. This is called the Pharamond friction hitch, and I use all these quick release knots. I don't use bungees at all for my setup. I think learning these knots is very empowering, and there's a great sense of satisfaction when you come out and camp and you can set up your tarp and your camp with knots that you've learned. Right, this is for my good friend Paul, 007 Vauxhall. He's just started to do some bushcrafting and camping in the woods. I think he's doing his first woodland camp very soon, actually. This is how I set my hammock up, Paul, because I know you asked how do you set your hammock up, and I think he's obviously thinking of getting a hammock. And I use these sort of climbing tape, and They're very similar to tree huggers. Well, they are tree huggers. Mine is homemade, and I've tied what's called a water knot loop. And if you go onto YouTube and search for water knot loop, it will show you how to actually tie that loop. And simply, all you've got to do is pass it around the tree, and that's never going to go anywhere. And the good thing is, it's wide tape and it doesn't damage the tree bark. And my hammock happens to be a DD travel hammock. There are many, many good hammocks on the market, but you know, I get on well with a DD travel hammock. And then what you need to do is get yourself a couple of climbing grade carabiners. They'll take a lot of weight. And then I form this clove hitch. It's so simple. It's simply a matter of get your two fingers, form a loop like that, and then form another loop. Put them side by side, and then put your carabiner through the clove hitch. It's easy to adjust, as long as there hasn't been any weight in the hammock at this stage. You can just loosen off. I wanted to slacken it a little bit and move the hammock a bit that way. So I'm just going to give it a bit of slack and just edge it across that way. And then when you're happy with the position, just lock it off with a half hitch, and that just stops it from slipping if it should ever slip. I've made that end lower, and it seems counterintuitive, but that's my head end. And in a hammock, believe me, if you have the head lower than the feet, you'll sleep better. Now for the moment of truth, will it take my weight? I've used these knots in this system for the last 3 or 4 years now, so I'm fairly confident I won't have any problems. I may just adjust the head end a little bit higher up, it's perhaps a little bit too low, but I like it just slightly off of horizontal, my head just slightly lower, and that way I'll sleep very well. And look at the lovely view I've got. What's wrong with you? Do you want to join me in the hammock? Bit too early for bed yet. Bit too early. Well, that pretty much concludes my hammock and tarp setup. This system has never let me down in many, many camps.
This brings me on to the meat of the video, so to speak. The catapult. Well, I fitted this one with a single theramount, theraband, single theraband gold. 25mm tapering to 20mm, and it's adequate for target practice firing small ball bearings 8 to 10mm in diameter. It shoots over the top, in other words, the bands fold over the top. I'm extremely pleased with it, and my accuracy and consistency is improving with practice. But like all things, it takes practice. You know, you've got to build up your muscle strength, you've got to build up muscle memory and technique. I've been watching this guy on YouTube called Bill Hayes, and I'll put a link. If you're interested in catapult shooting, you really need to go and check out his website, because he's absolutely fantastic. And we've got a guy in the UK, Gamekeeper John as well, another fantastic shot. And I've been studying their shooting technique, and they don't shoot the catapult that way, which is how I thought you used to shoot a catapult. They actually shoot with it on the side. And Bill Hayes goes into some detail about his shooting technique, and he says that you aim it like a shotgun or a rifle, and that you're looking along the bands, and you pull back to your anchor point, you look along the bands. And so I've been practicing his technique, and natural fact, I actually went and bought myself one of Bill's catapults, and I've got this beautiful Hathcock target sniper in aluminium. It's a beautiful design, and it fits very ergonomically into the hands. And this one I fitted with twin theraband. This is 20mm tapering down to 15mm with a leather pouch at the end. And this is more suited to firing the heavy ammo. It's also harder to pull back and you need more strength, but I'm beginning to develop that. And the ammunition I'm using with the lightweight band is simply the BBs, the ball bearings 8 to 10 mil in diameter. And I've cast myself a small pouch of 12 mil lead. 12 mil lead there. With the twin TheraBand gold on this catapult, it should propel that lead at around 240 to 250 feet per second, which gives a kinetic energy of 21 foot-pounds, which is twice the power of a UK non-licensed air rifle. So I mean, a non-licensed air rifle in the UK is limited to 12 foot-pounds of kinetic energy, muzzle energy. So we've got almost twice as much power as that. So this is well capable of taking small game and hunting, in, if the situation where I needed to hunt for food ever arose. But of course, I mean, that we're going into the realms of potential fantasy there. So I don't intend shooting living creatures with my catapult. It's purely for target practice and a bit of fun. Anyway, about 15 to 18 metres away, I've just positioned a small target, and we'll have a go at shooting that. First up, the steel BBs and the Watcherman over the top catapult. Hit the target. You can possibly hear even the impact from these steel BBs. Is some force. I wouldn't want to get hit by it. That one missed. Actually hear the BB rattling on through the trees beyond.
There you go, that's the Wiltshire Man catapult in action.
Now we'll have a go with the twin thigh band on the Bill Hayes catapult. Firing 12mm lead. This is a lethal combination.
Got a new target to shoot at now, so I'll go and dangle this from the string about 18 yards. You see if we can hit it. Catapult of choice would be the homemade Wiltshire Man catapult, firing steel BBs, and I'll zoom you in so you can see what's happening. Yeah, we should have you more or less in the centre of the shot now. Centre of the shot, more or less. There it is, a bit better. That's better. That's my target. So we're looking at about 18 to 19 yards on the cam. There we go, first shot. What a wallop. So that's not bad shooting. You can see it really hits with some force. Well, let's take a look, take off the tripod and see what it's done to the can. You've got to bear in mind that these cans are only thin aluminium. But there's not there's not much left of the can. That's really hit it with some impact. Impressive. Well, that concludes the experiments and the final shooting of the Wiltshire Man OTT slingshot and the Bill Hayes half-cock target sniper. It's a wonderful discipline. It's not the easiest method to shoot. I mean, you know, there are, compared to rifles and shotguns, I mean, you've got a lot more skill required with this. But it's a discipline I think I'll maintain and on a regular basis. And at home, I've rigged up a catch box so that when I shoot, my ammo gets caught and then I can recycle it and use it over and over again. Obviously, those shots I've taken here, the balls have gone on into the wood, and I doubt I'll ever recover any of them. But it's a very cheap and effective form of shooting. Even a piece like that, you're looking at £50. So it's not expensive. As I say, this one shoots just as well, and it cost me virtually nothing. Anyway, I'm going to just make a bite to eat and settle down into camp for this evening. I'm hoping that we'll get some rain later on, so I do love camping in the rain. But having said that, we've got a beautiful sunset. We've probably got a good 2 hours of sunlight left yet. So I'll have a little rest now and maybe a little walk around later. And then who knows, we could get rain later on. Used as a game cover for rearing pheasants and partridges. And every now and again there's these little shelters with corrugated tin roofs. And I'll tell you a story. I was in this wood, about 50 or 60 yards that way, actually where I'm camped now, because it's one of my favourite spots in this particular woodland. And in the dead of night, it must have been about 2 o'clock in the morning or 3 o'clock in the morning, I heard this creaking and moaning of corrugated tin. And I wondered, what on earth could it be? Because, I mean, I've heard so many sounds at night in a wood. And to the untrained ear or for the person that's not familiar, it can be quite a scary place at night. But obviously the scariest thing in the wood is me, of course, the human being. But this creaking and this moaning of the corrugated tin at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning really woke me up and got me, my heart pounding, and I wondering what on earth it was. So my logic mind kicked in and I had to think, well, what on earth could that be? It had to be something rubbing against the tin. And I guessed that it was probably a deer scratching itself. So on my return the next morning, I closely examined the edges of the corrugated tin, and sure enough I could see sign of deer fur where the animals had been rubbing against it to scratch themselves. Now you can probably hear that most peculiar noise. And not many people actually hear this, but they're over there, and what that is, that's the sound of guinea fowl. And these are released here alongside with the pheasants. This is a pheasant release pen, and the guinea fowl are known to make this horrible squawking noise, and they're known as alarm birds. So should a predator like a fox or a bird of prey be in the vicinity, they will give a call like that. And obviously they're calling it like that just before they go to roost as well. And that will alarm the pheasants, and hopefully they won't be predated. Well, I'm warmly ensconced in my sleeping bag now. I've got my softy suit tucked under my knees, which makes for a very, very comfortable lie in the hammock. It's really, really,
really very comfortable indeed. I'm looking forward to just lying here, listening to the sounds of the wood at night, dozing off to sleep. I think there's a chance we may get some rain because there's a cold front moving in and you can feel the cold wind, especially outside the wood. In the wood it's a bit warmer. So hopefully we'll hear the sound of rain on the tarp at some point, I hope. Anyway, for now, it's good night from me, and I'll see you in the morning. Cold light at dawn. Hear the world waking up around me. Mm.